An image doesn't often contain the feeling of its subject. It doesn't transmit the dryness of the air or the grit in the wind. It fails to capture the heat of the day or the disorientation of matching horizons. It doesn't tell you just how quickly your gear can grip the sand, filling every crease and crevice with the skittering grains that tumble across a dune-filled desert. But an image's emptiness can be useful. It can give you the beauty, the story, and the science of a natural wonder, let you immerse your mind in the shape of a landscape and lose yourself in the rippling patterns of nature, without forcing you to battle the harshness and the perils of a land covered in a flowing sea of sand. In the southwest of the United States, at the edge of the Sonoran Desert, lies an extreme and captivating geological feature. Covering nearly 700 square kilometers or 270 square miles of barren desert, the Algodones Dunes rise out of the ancient windblown sands of prehistoric Lake Cahuilla, forming an impressive and expansive formation that yet only comprises a modest portion of an uncommon feature. The geological term for this feature is an erg, and it describes a broad, flat area of desert covered with windswept sands and little to no vegetation. And although that sand doesn't need to be piled into dunes to qualify, sometimes the most impressive dunes will be found in ergs, such as this one. Formed in a basin that collected a millennia of Colorado River carvings, the lake that once covered 5,700 square kilometers across California and northern Mexico has all but disappeared over the last 500 years, freeing the sediment that was left behind to blow across the barren desert and forming a band of dunes extending over 40 miles across the state. These regions are surprisingly rare considering the vastly few ingredients required to form a sand dune, but then again, maybe there's not a lot about a sand dune that's rare at all. Sand dune shapes can be dramatic, they can be beautiful, and altogether unique, but in their individual boldness, dunes tend to share some common characteristics. For instance, they all have a slope face where the wind actually blows the sand grains up and deposits the smaller granules over the edge of a crest. And then past that crest, they'll have a slip face, which can only get to a certain angle before the sand tends to collapse under its own weight, making these tiny avalanches that cascade down the side of the slip face. And although sand dunes will tend to have their own unique individual shapes, this slip face, in the absence of moisture, will always tend to have a very similar angle, between 30 and 35 degrees. That's the absolute maximum that this angle of repose can reach before falling and collapsing under its own weight. And although gravity may be the reason that sand falls down a slip face, it's actually the physics of the atmosphere that limit the height of a sand dune's formation. As dunes form in what's known as the convective boundary layer, a portion of the atmosphere that touches the Earth's surface and is easily heated as the planet warms from the sun. And as this layer heats up, a heating that's only exacerbated by the rock and sand of a barren desert, it becomes subject to tumultuous convection currents that work to create winds that carry the sand across the desert. But the winds created by these convection currents are confined within this lowest layer, capped off by an inversion layer above. And as the grains of a sand dune pile further and further up the slope, the dune can eventually reach the top of this convection boundary layer. And at this point, the formation itself begins to constrain the very winds which shape it, blocking and redirecting the swirling gusts around the dune and carving out new shapes and gullies, arresting the upward growth of the dune altogether. After seeing these impressive sculptures with my own eyes, I can't help but begin to think that maybe after a long enough look, one might start to understand the intrigue that eventually became an obsession for famed desert pioneer Ralph Alger Bagnold, culminating in the publication of his master work, The Physics of Blown Sand in Desert Dunes, in 1941, a guide that was so groundbreaking it's still even referenced today in the field and was just used by NASA most recently to study dunes on Mars. And maybe the science of these formations feels a bit dry, but there's a sort of underlying pattern, a sort of beauty within these dunes. There's a universal math, a window into a sped-up version of erosion that rings true throughout the entire solar system. And just a small peek at these dunes gives us a broader picture of not only how our planet works, but how other celestial bodies work as well. But just as this science has shifted our theories of water on Mars, maybe future Martian explorations will shift this dune science again, becoming reminiscent of the shifting dunes themselves. And maybe the universal truth of the sand is just how easily it changes and forgets. It covers up barriers, covers up history and the tracks of those who've traveled. In no time, the sands appear empty once again, but maybe this idea is as empty as an image. Because the truth, at least out here, is that the desert is seldom ever empty at all. This barrier right here, what divides the United States of California from Mexico.